NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory presents the Von Karman Lecture, a series of talks by scientists and engineers who are exploring our planet, our solar system, and all that lies beyond.
Hey, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. How's everyone tonight? Excellent. Cool. Well, thank you very much for coming out to join us. Comets have inspired awe and wonder since the dawn of history. Many scientists today believe that comets crashed into Earth in its formative period, spewing organic molecules that were crucial to the growth of life. And while some scientists think that comets and planets were both made from the same clumps of dust and ice that came from that sun's birth, others think that these roving time capsules are even older than that, and that they may contain grains of interstellar stuff that may be far older than our solar system. The Rosetta spacecraft, which is a European Space Agency and NASA collaboration, will drop a lander on a comet's surface. But the mission has already started sending a wealth of information about its strange-looking destination. Tonight's guests will talk about what we have learned about the comet so far, what the Rosetta mission will be investigating in the upcoming months, and how we will attempt this incredibly risky landing. Our first guest has been at JPL for 34 years, in which time he has worked on approximately 15 missions, including Voyager, Galileo, Ulysses, Cassini, and Mars Pathfinder. He also managed a NASA program which built many ultralight and inflatable structures for space, including a tennis court-sized inflatable antenna tested from the space shuttle. Right now, he is the project manager for the NASA contribution to the Rosetta mission, which after 10 years of flight is today only 13 kilometers from its target comet. So to start things off tonight, please help me welcome Mr. Art Chmielewski.
Hello and warm welcome. Thank you so much for devoting your precious evening to us and to comets. We're thrilled to have you here. So let's start with a quick summary of our mission.
When the Rosetta spacecraft set off for a rendezvous and landing on the distant comet 67P Churyumov Gerasimenko.
Comets are really important. They're like a time capsule back to our past. They were formed just as the planets were formed in solar system formation.
We'd like to understand then is that the original material that the solar system kind of went from something like that to water and oceans and palm trees and the like. How do we know what our original solar system was made out of? Does the comet really represent some of that original material? And it's so very different. How do we get, you know, from there to where we are now?
Okay, this would conclude our presentation. Are there any questions? Well, we want to tell you more. We're very excited about this mission, and we want to tell you more. First of all, let's start with the name. Why is it called Rosetta? So all of you are familiar with Egyptian writing, and up to about 100 years ago, we all saw these pictures, but we did not understand the writing. And it all changed. It all changed with just one stone, and it was called a Rosetta stone because it came from the city of Rosetta. And luckily enough, on this stone, we had the same, almost the same text written in three languages. One of them were hieroglyphs, but the other one was ancient Greek. And because the text was almost identical, the scientist who discovered it, he was able to decipher more or less what these symbols mean. So the stone allowed us to understand so much more about early civilization of Egypt. Now, many scientists believe that our solar system started like this. It's a nebula, it's a gas, it's a chaotic kind of gas structure. And we want our Rosetta, we want our spacecraft called Rosetta to decipher this. Because how did we go from this to this? This beautiful planet, this beautiful solar system, planets rotating, revolving around the sun, beautiful structure, organized structure, but it all started with chaos like this. So we need our Rosetta Stone. And the Rosetta mission was designed to become this Rosetta Stone of the solar system. In addition to understanding the solar system, many scientists believe that our water that we drink every day, and some of us even shower in. Who showered this morning? You showered in a comet. They believe that maybe you showered in a comet. So, but we want to prove to this theory. And it can be done by conducting measurements at a comet. So the European Space Agency built this spacecraft, and NASA contributed to it, scientific instruments, antennas that receive and send the data. We do navigation in addition to the Europeans. We have also software that allows us to plan and coordinate science measurements of all of these instruments on board. And we'll talk about these instruments a little bit later on. Claudia Alexander, who is the project scientist, is here, and she's going to tell you a little bit more about comets. So this is the Rosetta spacecraft. It was built 10 years ago. It was launched 10 years ago. And so you're really lucky because all the scientists, some of them worked for maybe even 20 years designing this mission. And now is the culmination of all this hard work. We are 13 kilometers from the comet. And you didn't have to wait and worry about the spacecraft for these 10 years. You're here to get a lot of information, and then you're a month away from the landing and then escort phase. So congratulations on your timing. So the problem with catching up with comet, there are a lot of them. It's not easy. And the reason it's not easy, a lot of reasons that it's not easy. One of them is that the comet moves really, really fast. It goes maybe as fast as 35,000 miles an hour. 35,000 miles an hour. So we can't build a rocket that would go that fast. So we have to accelerate our spacecraft after launch. Also, it has comets, Jupiter family comets have these elongated paths, these elliptical orbits. So we have to get on this orbit. You don't try it here in the United States, but I'm from Poland, so I am very familiar with this idea that if you want to jump on the bus, because here in the United States, buses stop on the bus stops, okay? In Poland, we didn't have this luxury because it was inconvenient for the driver in the communist Poland. So you would have to figure out how to run exactly alongside of the bus and pick up the speed so you're running with the same speed. Then you could jump on it, right? And this is basically what we're facing here. And that's why we had this incredibly convoluted trajectory, because we had to go by the Earth three times, right, Claudia? And Mars one time. And every time we pick up a little bit of energy from a rotating planet. And then finally, we embarked on this elliptical trajectory. And now, this was supposed to be a pointer. Now we're here. After all of this, we're here. We're right by the comet. And we are going at exactly the same speed as the comet. So we entered into the orbit of the comet. And now we can observe the comet from up close. And in a month, we're going to drop a lander. So what are the comets? Well, most of the people imagine comets like they are pictured on this image here, which is an image of comet Hale-Bopp. You mostly from Earth, if you're an Earth observer, you mostly see the tail, and it's a dust tail. And basically what it is, it's a lot of dust particles reflecting the sunlight. And then if you're lucky, or the you can see also the second tail, and this is the ion tail. And these are the charged particles. But never you see the nucleus. And the nucleus is something that is extremely important to the scientists, because that's where all the action starts. This is where all the gas emanates from. This is where the gas gets kicked up. And so right now we're in orbit of the nucleus. Nucleus is frozen, and it's not so active when we're 3 astronomical units from Earth, which is 3 times the distance between Earth and the sun, 3 astronomical units. Comet is much colder, and now we can study it and orbit it. So a lot of things that we'll be talking to you about is the nucleus. And this is how a comet evolves here. You can see that this is the elliptical orbit. When it's here and it's past the orbit of Jupiter, about 5.3 AUs, astronomical units, and it's frozen. And then as it comes closer to the sun, it starts heating up. So we are somewhere here on the trajectory on this orbit of the comet around the sun. We're going to do the landing here. You can see it's not, hopefully, that much activity at that time. And then the tails start developing when we get closer to the perihelion, closer to the sun. So here is the sun. Here is Earth orbit. Here is Mars. Jupiter would be somewhere here. And the comet goes like this on this elliptical orbit. And we will follow after the landing. The landing is just, as our British project scientist likes to say, is just the cherry on top. We're going to follow the comet as it changes and observe it. And scientists are very excited about this. So let me introduce you to Claudia. Claudia Alexander is the NASA project scientist. She is extremely experienced and extremely knowledgeable to give this talk, unlike me. Because she's been on some prime JPL and NASA missions. She worked on Cassini. She worked on Galileo. As a matter of fact, you were a project manager of
I was Galileo. The last project manager of the Galileo mission to Jupiter.
Exciting missions.
I got to turn out the lights. I got to crash the spacecraft into the planet Jupiter on purpose. My friends always tell me to please remember to say on purpose, or they'll think that the woman driver got lost control and crashed it, not on purpose.
So here's Claudia, and 4 of you students, because there are some students from high school. She went to all your dream colleges, okay? She got undergraduate from Berkeley. She went for master's to UCLA and PhD to University of Michigan. A lot of you I know are interested in the University of Michigan, so maybe you can talk to her later about this. But now she's going to talk to you about comet.
Okay, so one of the reasons that we study the comets, and I like to think of the comets as the travelers. Okay, Art just described how difficult it was just to orbit our way out to meet a comet that was coming in and to meet it out by the orbit of Jupiter. Imagine going out to meet the comet in its home environment. So the comets are traveling to us, and we're lucky enough to be able to put a spacecraft together. I mean, it took about 20 years to get Rosetta from proposal, which I got I still have my proposal when I first got out of graduate school. One of the very first invitations I received was an opportunity to propose for the Rosetta mission in 1996. And then in all that time, we, you know, assembled it. We got ready. We had a launch delay. And then we finally got launched. And then we had 10 years to wait. So what I want to do here is back up in time and go back to where the comet's home is. And there are two comet homes, and I'm going to run this movie now, which we put together to try to explain not only the origin of the solar system, but where comets fit in and why we're so excited about studying a comet, because it's a traveler in distance and a traveler in time. So
just click and click.
Yeah, here we go.
Great.
So this is one of these ginormous molecular clouds. There are stars upon stars that are embedded in clouds like this that that start forming, and sometimes one end of the cloud doesn't know that there's stars forming in the other side. Something caused our particular part to collapse, and we started to have condensates happen, including the sun condensing in the center and protoplanets with angular momentum forming in the dust in the disk that's part of the extended collapsing cloud. And of course, we can't show you the inner solar system. What we have is the outer solar system. And the outer planets were unstable in their orbits, we believe. They were so unstable that they began to, there was a cataclysmic event in which the outer two switched places. So let's see if we see this. And as the outer two, Uranus and Neptune, switch places, they scatter all the debris that was in between Jupiter and Neptune was scattered out to what we call the Oort cloud. So the Oort cloud is 100,000 AU away, very, very large distance, almost to the next star. It's an enormous distance away, the Oort cloud. So now we have the solar system cleared out. But the purple stuff, you see the purple stuff, is the disk that remains. And that, to this day, remains as what we call the Kuiper Belt. And the Kuiper Belt is the second home of comets. So what we call the short-period comets come from the Kuiper Belt. They are in the same plane as the rest of the planets. They tend to, when they are distracted forward, using orbital mechanics, they get kicked forward. A lot of times they go into orbit around Jupiter. They become what we call Jupiter family comets. And then they can be kicked out again towards the sun, and they become short period comets that we can actually explore. So there's a short list of comets. That's another question that I'm often asked. Why did you pick comet Churyumov-Gerasimenko? You must have had some very special reasons to go to that special comet. And the answer is that we really have a short list of comets that we can pick as NASA or ESA investigators who want to explore comets. That's why the same comets seem to come up over and over again, Comet Temple 1, and so forth. But those are the ones that have traveled all the way, are in short periods around the sun, close enough that we can go, and in the same plane as the rest of the planets, so it's not too hard to launch a rocket to go out to meet them. Other Oort family, Oort cloud comets tend to come in at all sorts of strange angles. They come in on hyperbolic orbits that one time pass the sun and that's it. So it's much more difficult to catch up with an Oort family comet. We just have to observe those, and we do as much as we can while they're in town, shall we say. So I'm afraid that the rest of the charts I want to address for the purpose of this talk today are a little bit out of order. So next, what we have is, and I put this in here because when we, for 10 years, we've been thinking about our target, we didn't really have any close-up pictures, and we didn't really know what its mass was. We didn't know what its gravity field was. So we knew that when we got there, there would be a lot that we'd have to learn. But in our minds, I know in my mind, I had something in mind that was more like this, a sort of a round comet, bumpy with various inflections on it. In fact, looking with the Hubble Space Telescope, this was sort of the model that was published. And this is kind of the model that we had in our mind, that this would be our target. And imagine our surprise. And I'll show you what our real target looks like in a minute. And that's why this is somewhat out of order. Let's go to the next slide. Now, in its out-of-orderness, this I was going to show last is one of my favorite. A lot of the scientists on the team, this is one of our favorite shots. This is actually a selfie. Okay, this is the spacecraft, and this is a picture from the lander camera along the solar panels looking at our target. And I'll get to our target in a minute. You know, I'm going to go forward until I can find the picture that I wanted to show. Let's go backwards. Okay, so this is good enough. When we started getting closer enough to see that we had an incredible shape, some people started calling it the rubber duck. And I'm going to show our latest model here. This is what we really have. This is incredible. This is one of the coolest things we could have possibly, I mean, if we had planned it, I don't think we could have come up with a cooler object to try to study up close and personal. This superficially looks like a contact binary, what we would call a contact binary, because it looks like two objects stuck together in the middle. But we can't yet officially call it a contact binary because we would like to know if it isn't just an unusual erosion of an object in space. Has it sublimated in such a way that it's excavated this part of the comet? So in the months to come, we'll be looking at, are these two parts of the comet identical compositionally or different compositionally? And is one of them older than the other? So we've got a lot of exciting measurements to do. Of course, one of the jokes we had was, which one are we going to call Churyumov and which one are we going to call Gerasimenko? We probably will not call it either. There's an official naming convention that will officially name all the regions and so forth, so we don't get to go take that joke any further. Okay, so let's go backwards. Okay, here's our selfie. What I wanted to talk about a little bit was how do the instruments work? The microwave instrument, the MIRO instrument, is one of the NASA contributed instruments. And this is a very sophisticated, this instrument, when flown around the Earth, is a 200 kilogram instrument, and we miniaturized it to about 20 grams, which was a very significant engineering feat. The first time it's been flown for planetary exploration, we expect to be able to fly it to many more planetary objects in the future. It can do a number of things, but one of the things that it does is sense the temperature. It's one of two instruments that is able to sense temperature, and it will do temperature and subsurface temperature. So we're very interested, of course, in how the materials that the comet make up allow the thermal wave to pass through. This is another beautiful picture of our target, and in this case, what it's showing is the gas coming out of the neck region. So this is what we call sublimation. Sublimation is a feature of cometary physics in which the ice that the comet has on its surface changes to gas directly. It doesn't go through the liquid phase. So it's not comet evaporation, it's comet sublimation, and we expect to have parts where the comet is sublimating from various cracks, but we really don't understand how the sublimation process works. And one of the reasons we're there is to really study how the object warms up and how this, what we expect to be largely icy but a lot also dusty object, accepts the solar radiation and lets the particles go loose in the sublimation physics. How does that happen? And where does this gas come out? Are there actually cracks in the surface where this comes out? Or is this actually coming out from the side of a cliff? Is there a certain kind of physics where you have the the fall of material that lets the icy material be exposed. We have a lot of questions about how that works. And back in my day, when I did my dissertation, for example, all the physics that we thought about where there's a crust, it's kind of like an Oreo cookie where you have the darkened black crust on top, maybe with organics, maybe a goofy, goopy tholin type material, that and all the ice is underneath, that is probably not how it works. So we're very interested in how this works. Okay, now it's time for the 3D glasses. Okay, I didn't bring my 3D glasses. But this is a wonderful shot, and I'm going to give you a chance to enjoy it. And I would just point out a few things. One is this feature here looks like a landslide, but we're going to be very interested in exactly what is the morphology of the comet, and how would you exactly describe some of these features? Is this a regolith, like a planet or a moon would have a structured regolith? Or is this more what we call a lag deposit, where you've evacuated certain materials of ice and then it collapses? Okay, so we're very interested in what is the topography, what is the geomorphology, and what is the physics of this object? So I'm going to move on, and maybe at the end of the lecture we can go back to the 3D picture if you like. Okay, so MIRO, we talked about the MIRO instrument being able to determine the temperature, and this is one of the maps that MIRO was recently put together, completely different from the round object, even an object like this, which is not round and has certain inflections on it. And so one of the things that we had to do was put together the a surface map and then map the various thermal waves onto it. So this gets us closer to understanding how the comet warms up. And as we go forward, as the comet goes around the sun and gets even warmer, we will be, of course, studying the thermal wave as it goes around. What is a comet made of? I mentioned that it was very black, or if I didn't mention that it was very black, this is my opportunity to say that even though we think that it's of it as an icy object, and we think of the tail as being ice that is sublimating off and making this enormous, beautiful tail throughout space, in fact, the surface is as dark as the toner we used to use in our printers, you know, that powdery stuff from 10 years ago that they don't use anymore. And we think that interstellar dust particles might be sort of stuck together, might be what this is made of, and with an icy overlayer. And so there's a lot of normal materials that we recognize, diamond, graphite, titanium carbide, and various other components of interstellar dust. In small particles, spinel, of course, is a material that's recognized. It makes up a lot of the interior of the Earth. So we're looking for what are the mineral assemblages that are part of this, and then what are the ices that may be sticking this stuff together, and then why is it so black? Is that because we have organics, perhaps, that are part of this mix that make this a very extraterrestrial type of interplanetary object? Another NASA-contributed instrument is the ALICE instrument, which is, ALICE is a name, it's not an acronym. The PI thought it would be interesting or cute or interesting to just give it a name instead of an acronym. It is an ultraviolet spectrometer, and again, this is the first time that we've flown an ultraviolet spectrometer into space to study a planetary object. How does an ultraviolet spectrometer work? I had wanted our illustrator to give us a skyline, like the New York skyline, and then some of the districts, you know, the financial district, the contribution is, you know, from one element, and Broadway is contributed by another element, and Tribeca is contributed by another element, and you get the whole thing together as like a skyline, but the various components of the surface make these peaks. And what the scientists do is back out of this scramble, how it's all scrambled together, they'll back out what the individual components of the surface are. And so the ALICE instrument will do that for us in the ultraviolet frequency band. CONCERT is another instrument that we have made a contribution to here at JPL. I like this chart because what it shows is that basically you're going to have a CONCERT experiment on the nucleus and one in space above, and they're going to send radio waves through the nucleus. It's kind of like an ultrasound. It's called a tomography experiment, but that's kind of like an ultrasound. And depending on what the material is made of, especially if there's any layers inside, the radio waves will penetrate through at various different speeds. They'll be slowed down by what's inside. And then back at home, we will try to deconvolve what happens to the signal in terms of what the material is made of inside. And I have to admit, this is one of my favorite experiments, and that's why I included it. This is another, I'm not going to show the movie, or maybe I will show the movie while I'm talking. The Virtus instrument is not, this is an Italian instrument, and what it does, it also measures the temperature. It doesn't measure down to as many... It doesn't have the wavelength range that the Miro instrument does in terms of measuring temperature, but there are places where the temperature will overlap. And what this early measurement was that the surface is warmer than we thought that it ought to be for an icy body. And I believe that that can be attributed to the fact that this object is probably dustier than we expect. It's a dusty object, and we kind of know that. On the outbound leg is the dustier leg, is something that we already know. Now, here's a movie that I want to show. Happened early on. We had an outburst. There it is. So let's show that again. This happened in late April, early May, just about the time that we, doggone it, just about the time that we had turned the camera on. This is actually a globular cluster in the background. I think it's a really beautiful juxtaposition of an interplanetary object and an extraplanetary, out of the solar system object. Anyway, let's look at that one more time. As we suddenly had an outburst looking like a tail in May, we were out at 3.5 AU. What in the world would cause the comet, way before the tail develops normally, to have that kind of an outburst? And was that, what kind of gas was that? Is that water, or was it carbon dioxide, carbon monoxide? What was powering? We think this was probably dust, an outburst of the dusty tail, but it had to have been powered by something, and that's something that we don't yet know. All right, so let's go on to the next thing. I mentioned a little bit about a regolith. One of the things we want to understand is just what are the properties of this nucleus? Does it have layers like a planet, like the Earth or Moon? Or is it more of what's called a lag deposit, or a more random accumulation of bits? And that will affect how the heat is transferred inside. So we will be studying the thermal conductivity and by other means, trying to figure out really what the material looks like inside. So now we're going to go back to some of our incredible pictures where, again, these boulders are probably the size of houses. Just to give you an idea of the scale, you know, geologists usually take pictures of hammers or quarters to try to give an idea of the scale, and we don't have an opportunity to do that. So and I can't, in this lecture, articulate for you what some of the geomorphology features, some of the geological features. Are these plains? Are they dust? Are they sand? Are they, or are they icy, like the surface of a lake? Are these sediments, or are they what we described above on the previous picture, kind of a regolith that we'll have a chance to study? These are all things that we will learn better in the coming months and have a much greater opportunity to study under different lighting conditions. We'll learn much more in the months to come. This I threw in to give an idea of the scales. This is sort of an informal, just giving an idea of the size. This is in kilometers, so probably 4 kilometers one way and maybe 3.5 kilometers the other way, and then the width as indicated, approximately, for those of you who like to draw scale models. Again, I think I showed this one already. This is an image produced by one of our amateurs. We have a campaign underway with amateur astronomers. If any of you are interested in being part of our amateur astronomer campaign, talk to me afterwards. Some of our amateurs got impatient and went to Photoshop with the officially released pictures and embellished them. Sometimes they got silly and showed how the surface looked like Middle Earth and so forth. But this was done by John Goodrick, and I appreciate his work here, trying to give us an even closer look at what this kind of mysterious extraterrestrial environment could be like. This is another view of the gas coming out of the neck region. Again, for me, I'm very interested in what is coming out of this vent. Is it, can we get chunks of material from deeper inside? Will we have a chance even to fly through some of these jets? We will be taking a look at that in the planning process in the months to come. Again, just another beautiful shot of our beautiful target. And I think that is the end. I'm going to turn it back over to Mr. Chmielewski.
Thank you, Claudia. So Claudia told you about this amazing object. It's amazing and scary. Scary, it's amazing to scientists, it's scary to engineers. And that's why we also have engineers and scientists on these missions. For example, Claudia is a project scientist. I am a project manager, engineering background, scientific background. And the reason JPL and NASA likes to do this is because they want to keep the balance. It's like in a court. Because if we only build spacecraft by engineers, then there would be a beautiful spacecraft going very fast and doing nothing. On the other hand, if we turn it over to scientists, there would be these amazing instruments and wouldn't get off the ground. It's like kind of like, you know, a Ferrari and a Mercedes. Ferrari, you know, F40 doesn't even have window cranks, okay? Because it's just built for speed, and Mercedes, you know, will have all the options. So that's our role. So let's talk about engineering of landing on Comet, okay? And as you can imagine, not an easy thing. And it's not an easy thing because this is how we imagine that this thing's going to look like. Right? As a matter of fact, you know, I got this. This was a Hubble first light curve for Hubble measurements, and I created this, and I showed it to a few scientists, and they said, don't show it to me. These are artifacts of manipulation of image. It's just going to be round. It's not going to be this interesting. I know you want to make it interesting, but it's going to be a sphere, okay? A basketball. I said, oh, okay, all right, so. Well, nobody expected this. As a matter of fact, I was at a meeting in Europe, and it says, did you guys, and then one scientist said, did you guys design it in Hollywood? Because this looks worse than Armageddon. Okay. So, you know, we engineers would like to land on something like this, but it ain't going to happen. It's going to be this. So I'm here to tell you about how you land on this, okay? So please be gentle. Okay. Even Lulu is scared of this landing. All right, so first of all, we have to pick a landing site, okay? And the landing, a good landing site would be actually one where you can actually reach it with a spacecraft. And because this comet rotates in a bizarre way, okay, it's not very easy to reach all the sites. So these green dots show you, the navigators calculated, okay, you can reach these sites. And they also looked at the slopes, and they said, okay, the slopes are a little scary. And they looked also, what is the illumination of the comet? Because as it turns, just like Earth, it has day and night, right? And it turns out that if you want to learn, if you want to land on a comet, right, there's a battery on the lander, and it will last only 3 days. The primary battery, only 3 days after this 10-year travel. But there are also solar arrays. It's covered with solar arrays, producing a whole 10 watt. And it will recharge the secondary battery. So then if you recharge it every week, 2 weeks, depending on the angle, where you land it, may recharge the battery, and you can perform your science experiments on the lander again. So you have to be somewhere, we figured out, where there is day and night, and pretty much even day and night. Because if it's too much sunlight, then the lander will quickly overheat. If it's too little, it will freeze, and it will not get the energy into the battery, right? So your red here is completely illuminated. Your blue is completely in the darkness. And you want to be somewhere where yellow is, OK? So let me show you how this landing is going to take place. Ideally, this is a movie. There's a movie made before we saw what the comet looks like. So here's the spacecraft. You see a spacecraft. It has a little lander attached to it. The spacecraft is about the size of a SUV. The spacecraft is about the size of a stove. Right, and it's a stove made out of maybe styrofoam, because this is not 7 minutes of terror. Okay, this is 7 hours of scary patience. So, the lander will descend from 22 kilometers for 7 hours, and hopefully will land like this. Yes? Okay. Yeah, that's what we want to see. So now, we certainly don't want to see this. You know, there are a lot of boulders on the surface. And that's just really scary proposition. Claudia showed you how many boulders. And these are boulders size of this auditorium or bigger, OK? And we cannot control this lander so accurately, because this is basically, after the release, the baby goes, OK? And we can't do anything about it. It kind of descends, and it descends, you know, pretty much like at this speed. Okay, it's about a meter per second or so. So it comes down like this, 7 hours. Okay, and we can't control it. There's a gyro on board that stabilizes it to make sure that that the legs are pointing down, but we can't really precisely control it. We also don't want some jet to develop somewhere underneath us. And you know, these things, like Claudia showed you, outbursts. What if we have an outburst? We cannot also land on a slope that's more than 30 degrees, because what's going to happen to this guy? We'll tilt over, right? And there are, unfortunately, a lot of slopes everywhere. So that's another thing that limits the landing. And how much dust is there? Okay, or is it like a sinkhole? Are we going to sink in dust? Is it going to be 10 centimeters, 2 centimeters? You tell me. I don't know. No, you don't tell me, because you don't know, and I don't know, and nobody knows. So we picked 5 sites, and they are called, you can see, A, B, C, and then it's I and J, because there were originally 10 sites, which we eliminated. We went to 5. And then we looked at these 5. And some of them we eliminated also very quickly, because it turned out that as the lander, for example, site, this site was was eliminated very quickly. This side here, side A, because it turned out the side A was right here. And the navigators at ESA realized that to get to this side, the spacecraft would just barely miss the head of the duck, as they like to call it. Or is it a monopoly boot?
I think of it as a monopoly boot.
Okay, that's more elegant than a duck. Okay. They really struggle with this. You know, they say, no duck, no duck. It's a main lobe, minor lobe, and major lobe, okay? And then 2 minutes later, somebody says, well, you know, if we land on the head of the duck. So, for example, to miss the head of the duck and land on the feathers of the duck here, you know, that would be, we would be missing the head by about 150 feet. That's much too close for comfort. So that was eliminated. And then, you know, we studied all of these things, how many boulders there are, you know, how, what are the slopes at all of these places. And we finally decided that this was an early favorite. The engineers wanted to, when they saw this, they started calling it heliport. Okay? And a heliport, this is also kind of interesting how humans function. And somebody else called the competing site Death Valley. So there was a vote between heliport and Death Valley. Where would you go? Well, it turned out that heliport was, there was more death at heliport than at Death Valley. But you can see, it turned out later, upon further review, that it has about 350 boulders the size of SUVs. So we're not going there. And we're going here to site J. And site J is on the head of the duck, right here. This was the heliport, and it turned out to be hell's port, right here. And the site J is right here on the head of the major lobe. I'm sorry, the minor lobe. Okay. And so this place is not perfect. It's far from perfect, but it's not tragical. Okay. If for all of these things that I discussed, it's kind of, you know, like maybe you had a boyfriend that was in a punk rock when you were, you know, in your dating stages and had great tattoos and played great drums and, you know, and had great body piercings. It was really exciting. But then you'd rather get married to a librarian. So, you know, this is our librarian on the comet, okay? It's, you know, we don't want that much excitement, okay? Okay, so here you can see the librarian versus the punk rocker. And unfortunately, also, you can see that, and I'll play it for you in 3D here, so you can see that the librarian gets upset from time to time, too. And that's a weird thing. So here is our site J. And you can see there are some slopes much greater than 30 degrees, right? And there are some, you know, how much dust is, how many crevices, how many stones are there. You know, that's just, and this is about a kilometer by kilometer. And our landing area where we can pretty much figure out, let me play it again, where are we going to be is maybe with accuracy of about, you know, 200 by 400 meters. So, you know, we're going to land somewhere here. Okay? Now, that's scary. This is what's going to happen on the 12th of November at 7:35 a.m. in California. So, and also, of course, after we successfully land, and will we successfully land? Thank you. We're going to have to conduct some science. And there are 10 instruments on board of the Philae lander. So there are some experiments that test what is this mechanical order, the mechanical properties and electrical properties of the soil. Just the landing itself will tell us a lot about where we landed and what are the properties there. The landing, even the touchdown, even if we land like this, this will be very scary and a lot of things have to go right because the comet has such a low gravity that as we go for a touchdown, if I jump and land, I land, okay? When a lander comes on a comet, lands on a comet, and lands, it would bounce immediately back. So to prevent this, what do we do? At the moment of landing, we fire a jet here to press it down, and then we fire two harpoons down, okay? So now we fire these harpoons into what? Into 2 meters of dust? Are we firing them into, you know, concrete like amorphous ice? It's we just didn't know. ESA did not know this. So this is I really admire the spirit of this mission. It's a true exploration mission. You know, we go where we have never been before. And that's an amazing mission. And then we perform a lot of experiment. Claudia told you about the concert. That's a very exciting experiment with tomography of the comet. So the lander would have to be on one side of the comet and the orbiter on the other side for the radio signal to go through. That's very interesting. We have a little drill that goes about 30 centimeters inside and pulls the material up and puts on little ovens. And then we evaporate the material and we see what this gas is to see what is the composition of the surface of the comet. We have a little hammer that hammers into the surface, so it will tell us about electrical and mechanical properties of this area. We'll measure also thermal conductivity. And of all of these experiments, when you put it all together, jointly with the orbiter information, you know, we're going to have an idea. What is this? What is the chemical composition? Are these different bodies? Is it hundreds of different bodies in this comet? This is what scientists will be sorting for years to come. So this will go on for almost 2 years after the landing. So as Matt Taylor says, it's a landing is just a cherry on top of cake. The scientists will, that doesn't matter if it's successful or not successful, we'll still go on with the Rosetta mission, and we will study it for 2 years as the comet heats up and develops tails and maybe splits into Churyumov and Gerasimenko. No, I didn't say that. Into major lobe and minor lobe, yeah. And as a matter of fact, actually, we can see a little crack here already developing, so that would be interesting. Although the scientists say that that's not going to happen. We'll see. It will be very interesting to geologists. It will be tragical, again, to the navigators. How do you fly by these two objects? There will be a landing. There will be landing on the 12th of November at 7:35. We want you to pay attention. We want you to drink your coffee, turn on TV. Look at the news. Claudia, I'm sure, will be on ABC News. So pay attention. You know, we're all scientists and engineers here, so do this as we're landing for 7 hours. Don't let go for 7 hours. And the landing will be successful, right?
Yes.
Okay, very well. So thank you so much for your attention, and Claudia and I will be glad to answer some questions. If you have a question, please come up to the microphone. Yes.
Oh, thank you for the talk. What speed does the comet rotate at, and does it have really unusual rotation properties, or does it have poles the way you would think of a spherical object having poles?
Well, the rotational period is, I think, 12 hours and 24 minutes right now. And what is interesting about it is that it has changed. It was measured before, and it was something like 12 hours 41 minutes. So the scientists also are trying to sort out what happened at the rotational speed change. But it's about half a Earth day.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you. When the lander lands and you get closer to the sun and the solar wind starts pushing it more, the tail starts expanding, is the lander expected to be able to keep functioning even under those as that situation gets more extreme? And are you expecting, if it can, do you think you'll see something really interesting in that period?
Wouldn't it be great for the jets to blow the lander off the comet?
Well, you said the gravity's so light. Then, I don't know.
It's screwed in. It's harpooned.
Oh, yeah. I forgot the harpoons. Okay. Yeah,
so the lander will probably work no longer than a month, 30 days. Mm-hmm. And the reason for this is there are a lot of reasons. First of all, it may do this, right? Then it can melt. You know, it will overcook. It will be too hot for it to operate. You know, you can also lose energy because, you know, the ice can and dust can deposit on solar arrays, so it will not be able to recharge the array. So, you know, the instruments will not be able to operate and will not be able to transmit.
But we're looking forward to having it come back, you know, to recharge and to be able to reuse the lander two or maybe three more times.
Yeah. But certainly we want to have a successful landing and followed by this longer period of landed science, which is at least 30 days.
Thank you.
Yeah, you probably learned a lot about how to rendezvous with things while you were doing this. Do you have any intention, or is it helpful in learning and maybe planning how to eventually zap and rendezvous with asteroids? Do you learn that from this by any chance, or is that a completely different issue?
Absolutely. Now, it's not a completely different issue. It's navigation around small bodies is something that we really want to learn because small bodies are in.
We want. Absolutely right.
So the comet black, you know, very dark bodies, is, and asteroid black is the new black. They are. We really want to learn how to navigate around these bodies. For example, right now, NASA and ESA in parallel try to determine the orbit of the spacecraft around the comet, and they're comparing their solutions. They are about 200 meters within each other, so that's really a great achievement. Asteroids are much larger, so there's more gravity. We already landed on one asteroid. But comets are much more difficult. They change also their trajectory due to jets.
Yeah, I mean, I think asteroids are denser, so the gravity itself is much more robust than around a comet. And then navigating around a comet is like you have to predict the weather. I keep comparing it to navigating, you know, that volcano in Iceland that goes off and regular commercial pilots say, we are not going there, you know, because we can't fly through this dusty. And we, you know, engineers have the same problem with spacecraft navigating around a comet that's emitting clouds of stuff. So we do, if we ever want to do this again, definitely we will be learning from Rosetta.
Yes.
Yeah, well, first a little bit of silliness. One of my colleagues has suggested that if, in fact, it is a contact binary, desideratum for the names is that Churyumov is a shorter name and should therefore name the smaller part. a more serious question. You mentioned the slopes. Is that mentioned measured with respect to the gravitational gradient at each point on the surface? And are you getting the gravitational gradient by analyzing the orbital motions in the way that Shogren did with the moon and that Konopleff is doing now with Mars?
An excellent question. Maybe you can throw in something into this because it's a very complicated problem. But we're calculating the slopes with respect to the normal, to the position, expected position of the lander at impact, right? And this is, of course, the gravity has huge, is a huge component of this. But the gravity of this body is about 1/10,000th of Earth's gravity, so it's very small. Also, impact of gas is huge on the lander, is almost, I think, as large as maybe 1/3 of gravity. So So the slopes are calculated with respect to the normal to the ascendance of the lander. And then your second part of your question was?
Are you getting information about the gravitational gradient the same way that Chmielewski did for the moon and Comets is doing for Mars?
Yeah. Well, gravity, shall I say more? You know, what's the gravity gravity around this body? It's even very difficult. Normally, we get gravity from radio, from the spacecraft, you know, Doppler shift as the spacecraft gets closer to the comet, you know, and it's farther away. We always know how the spacecraft interacts with the body, so we can estimate gravity that way. I'm not sure how it's going to be done here.
Yeah,
it's very difficult.
All I know is that the radio science people are working on their gravity experiment as we speak right now, and that, you know, we almost did not have the gravity determination done in time for the landing, so that they will be refining the gravity, especially the extra lobes of gravity as we go forward. But I cannot answer your question. I'm sorry.
Yes.
Yes. What is the probability of finding abiogenesis on the comet, as it were?
Abiogenesis.
Mm-hmm.
Can you explain that term, please?
Okay, that term is a combination of living matter and non-living matter. And so therefore, they're talking about perhaps the building blocks that created life forms to begin with. And so therefore, because they put Rosetta through the clean room, they wanted to make sure all the microbial life was removed from it. But therefore, it might assume more microbial life once it's landed.
I mean, they will have everything they need to determine, you know, the elements and molecules, organic material, that is there. You know, if we detect, you're asking if we detect some sort of biological signature, would we have the instrumentation to determine that? I think we do. We've got, you know, we've got the ability to look at up to 300 AMUs in the vicinity. And the question is being able to, if you determine that there's organic material there, being able to say that it is like a virus or like a bacteria, or is it, you know, an abiotic kind of a molecule. And I think that we have the capability to do that. I think we'll be able to say whether or not, but we don't have anything that will measure beyond 300 AMU in terms of the particle size of the molecule.
You might have to qualify your biological signatures, though, once you reach the comet. You know, in other words, like expand your knowledge.
You know, I think what we really want is to be able to find organic material. Okay, we are really looking forward to finding organic material, and if we do, because up until now we haven't, from the ground, seen organic material in a cometary environment. So we are very excited about bringing our sophisticated laboratory and being able to measure some of these exotic molecules both in the coma and on the surface. And so basically I'm waiting to see those signatures. And right now I'm not worried about being able to distinguish between an abiotic or a biologic signature. I think that would be an interesting problem to have when we get there. But I'm still waiting to see what kind of molecules we are able to measure.
Therefore, if you discover such things as microbial mats, then you might want to expand from there based upon the knowledge that's been acquired in the past.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, thanks for the great talk. I had a question that was kind of centered on the outgassing event that you had shown. Is there any evidence of any type of impact that might have happened, or is it, did it occur from like a section cleaving off and suddenly sublimating?
We don't know that yet. Yeah, we don't know that yet. We're 13 kilometers now. we need to, you know, do what we need to do in the weeks to come to be able to answer questions like that. We just haven't been there long enough to get the kind of data that will answer those questions. But that those are very interesting questions.
And the second half of that, is there any sensible estimates on how much dissolution of the body will happen as it gets closer to the sun?
You know, I think cometary scientists have asked ourselves, you know, how much of a mass loss happens as a comet goes around the sun. And the answer could be not very much. That in spite of the fact that you see these jets and they look pretty dramatic, there's actually not that much mass there. And in fact, one of the questions I have for our guys is, how do you know you're in one? I mean, when you fly through one of these, are you going to be able to tell that it's different from the nominal space outside? So it looks dramatic. I'm not sure how much mass loss there will be. At the same time, you saw the outburst that we had way early on. So there is the possibility of this shedding a good deal of its outer skin, enough to keep whatever's on the surface constantly fresh. It never gets old. So these are all things that we're waiting to see what happens in the weeks and months to come. So stay tuned.
Yeah, and you guys were telling me that there is a lot of this shedding, a lot of this evaporation, a lot of this sublimation, so the surface will be just dusty and smooth.
Yeah, we did. We also said that we're excited to see what we have never seen before, right? It's going places that you've never seen before. Yes.
Yes. Hi. I have a question regarding on the landing and how far we would go. So earlier you mentioned that regardless of the landing that happens with the Rosetta spacecraft, you said that over time we still be keeping track of it over 2 years. Now, how far would be the distance before we end up losing contact with the spacecraft on the rocket? Would it be over 2 years? Was that just an estimate? Or is that just as far away as we can keep track?
I don't imagine we will ever lose contact with the spacecraft. Because it's going around the sun, mm-hmm. So you know, when it goes, when we stop, when the mission, the so-called end of mission, is an arbitrary date that somebody threw a dart at the calendar and said, we're done.
Is it an estimate?
But we can stay in contact with the spacecraft as far out as it is, as far as close as it is, so we will always be in contact with both the spacecraft and the lander until the lander overheats. Yeah, okay, here we go. So here we are, approximately getting ready for our landing, which takes place at the red X, which you can't see the red X. Mm-hmm. We're, I guess, over here. But we were in contact with the spacecraft, you know, out here. And I guess you're right that there was a period at the aphelion part where we turned the spacecraft off. Okay. And when we did that, we turned off. We didn't have any signal, no beacon, no nothing. Very risky in terms of the engineering. But that's not because we couldn't have. It's because we were trying to preserve all the possible power into keeping the spacecraft warm.
So it wasn't the distance away that we couldn't reach. Okay.
No, there's no distance where the spacecraft will be out of touch.
We'll lose contact with the lander, but
Because it will overheat,
okay. But we'll not lose contact. The only reason we couldn't, for example, continue this mission further is because limitation of propellant, so you have to, you know, do attitude control and limitation of.
Yeah, but wouldn't that distance be the most, be even like another thing to look out for, something else that we haven't seen, or would it make a difference that we
you
can't
mean,
see that part?
That you mean distance? going out to the orbit of Jupiter, kind
yeah.
of? We have spacecraft that have gone beyond Jupiter.
Okay.
There's one.
Yeah. There's one. That's right. Okay. Cassini.
There's another one.
Okay. So we are not in a position of even Voyager, which is at where is Voyager exactly now? 50 AU, something like that. Over 100 AU. Right. So we are still getting signals even from Voyager. So I don't think there's, you know, with the 70-meter telescope, which is, you can imagine, that's about the size of a football field, you know, we are getting the signals from deep space. That's NASA's deep space network has the capability of you know, receiving the signals even from as far away as, you know, Voyager. So
thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you for the talk. I was wondering at the approximately what's going to be the escape velocity on the surface of this comet?
Escape velocity on the surface of the comet. Relatively low, probably.
Escape velocity, but, Paul, you just calculated this, didn't you?
Yeah.
It was about a meter.
Miles per hour.
Yeah. Wow. As a matter of fact, we calculated that what? The landing speed with which the spacecraft is landing is like, what, one-third or two-thirds of escape velocity?
Yeah.
Okay. So, yeah, so it's very low.
And one more thing. I'm not sure about this, but did the spacecraft go through, a triangular path before it gets to the orbit?
Yeah.
And what's the reason? Is there a specific reason for that?
Yeah, so you're referring to the early orbits. Yeah, when we approached the comet, we were in these triangular paths, so we were about 100 kilometers, and we flew these triangular orbits. And then as we assessed that there's not so much gas here, so it's safer to come closer, then we entered the orbits. They're circular, and we call them bound, because the actually gravity is holding the spacecraft. When you're that far, gravity has no impact on the spacecraft, so you know you can have any orbit of any shape. But it's all booking at 35,000 miles an hour at the same time, right? It's just that the relative position of the spacecraft to the comet is, you know, you can make it whatever you want. It's just a matter of using more or less propellant.
I mean, I might mention that we entertained for a long time the idea of square orbits, if you can imagine. To go into orbit, quote unquote, around an object that has so little gravity, we actually had these triangular shaped orbits, and you could build different sides of triangular shapes in order to be able to do the measurements that we intend to do. So it has been a really interesting and entertaining kind of new kind of a way to navigate around an object.
And a lot of these things are not very intuitional because it's of low gravity. You know, you would be a great basketball player on the comet. You know, take this, Kobe. Boom, because you could jump, you know, a kilometer up.
Yeah. Thank you.
I actually have two questions. First of all, how long is a day and night on the comet?
Okay.
And what will happen to the rest of the spacecraft after the lander is, on the comet?
Okay, so this comet, so a day and night is, so the full revolution of this comet is, so let's say we're starting by duck looking at you, okay? All right. So the full revolution, which is full day, will be when a duck is looking, duck is not looking, duck is showing its butt to you. Now duck is looking again. So that's one full revolution, and it's one day, and that's about 12 hours. So it's a half of a day here. And, you know, 6 hours of this will be night, and 6 hours will be a day. In some places, just like on Earth, there will be polar night, and there will be continuous illumination. And the second part of?
What will happen to the orbiter once the lander has been dispensed?
Oh, yeah. Well, it's kind of like sending college to a kid to college, you know? Orbiter will be very happy. and say, okay, now I don't have to worry about this guy. Well, 3 more days, son, you have a dorm? Good. You bought books? Good. All right, bye, see you in 4 years. So that's pretty much what's gonna happen. Maybe a month, we'll have extended science mission on surface, and after that, we'll not communicate.
I mean, the orbiter will keep going, okay? So we showed the rest of the trajectory here, and the comet will be heating up. So here's the warmest part is the red part here, and then it develops its beautiful tail, and all this time, the orbiter will be doing its measurements, okay? Maybe we'll even get a chance to fly through, you know, one of the jets, fingers crossed, okay? And then on the outbound leg, this is the dusty part. Yeah, you bet. Okay, these safety guys are just such killjoys. They don't want to do anything interesting. And then we stop right around here, And maybe potentially that we might keep going and come back around, but we haven't exactly decided what our end of mission scenario is going to be. But we might go back around and do it again. But basically, we do the landing, and then the orbiter keeps on going, doing a lot of important measurements that we still have things to learn, all the way through perihelion, where the tail is biggest. And then when the tail starts to die down, this is now in the different season. So if this were summer, this will be winter. And we'll be looking at, this is also the dusty side. So we are going to do seasonal variations, and we're going to look at what happens on the other side. Why is it dustier? Why is this side different from this side? And then we stop right around there.
Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you for an interesting question.
Thank you for the wonderful presentation. I heard you mention that you wanted to bring the module back, the landing module back, and reuse it again. Do you expect to have the landing module move around on the surface?
No, we will not. We were, even though in principle, yeah, we would like to have it back. But no, we're not going to bring it back. Okay, but the idea is that it has batteries that can be recharged. So we will continue to be able to use it. So the first part of the lander mission is maybe 3 days, and then the primary batteries will be used up. So then we'll go through a period where we'll recharge the batteries, and then hopefully we'll get a few more days, and then the secondary batteries will go belly up, and we'll maybe get to recharge them again. And we will continue to do that until it gets so warm that the lander is no longer functions because it gets too warm to function.
And when you hear that we will move around, it's not a rover, right? It has harpoons that hold it down, right? So it can't move. What moves is this upper body, right? This has capability of rotating. And of course, we have to pick up the instruments here, and then we can rotate so we can sample. But only, you know, like for example, this white stuff here, this is a drill that we drop, right? So we can drill here, rotate, but it's only, you know, within the radius of the rotation of the spacecraft, okay, of the lander.
Are there any few specific instruments that you can quickly discern if the comet is made of different bodies?
You know, I think that we'll be doing the sampling of material coming off, and as we go around, we'll be able to tell, you know, first of all, you have to trace back any particles that you get to find out where their point of origin was. And then, is there any compositional differences that would definitely, beyond a reasonable doubt, allow you to say one of them is older or one of them is chemically distinct from another? So I expect us to be able to do that, but I don't expect it to happen right away.
Okay. Thank you very much.
And let's have last question, please.
Yeah, and then we have to go to a couple online questions.
Oh, yes.
Thank you for the talk. One question, it was, what kind of effect would the, considering how low mass the actual comet is, what kind of effect would the gravitational field of the orbiter and the lander going to have on the orbit of the comet, if any?
What is the, I'm sorry, she was, could you repeat the question?
Yeah, so the, considering how low mass the comet is, what kind of effect, if any, would the gravitational fields of the orbiter and the lander going to have on the comet's orbit?
That's a really good question. Nonetheless, the lander and the orbiter are still much less mass than the comet. I mean, the comet is maybe the size of the Los Angeles basin. Maybe, you know, I've seen some pictures people have put online, size of the city of Los Angeles, you know, with extending up into the atmosphere by, you know, several miles. So it's still a lot more mass there than the spacecraft. But believe it or not, the presence of the other planets have an effect on the being able to navigate. It's navigation around an object like this is not simple because the mass is low and your mass is not as irrelevant as it would be around Earth or around Jupiter. So in spite of the fact that there's very little mass in the spacecraft, it's still closer to the comet. So you know, that's a really good question.
What will make eventually difference is as we get closer to the sun starts interacting with the spacecraft, and that's why we'll not be able to orbit. So, you know, as much as we're, well, this is my orbiter. So, you know, so right now we're able to fly like this because there is, you know, the spacecraft feels more gravity of the comet than gravity of the sun. But as we get closer to the sun is pulling the spacecrafts. So we kind of will be, this is how we're going to orbit, you know. This will be kind of a weavy flybys.
Thank you.
Okay. How about somebody? Okay. How about if you read it? We have a person who speaks English.
All right.
English,
the instruments, among the instruments, which are the ones that NASA or JPL is at the driving seat of? Okay, so we've contributed three. I said three and held up four. Okay. The Miro instrument, which I described, the microwave instrument, is a JPL instrument. The ALICE instrument, which I also described, is from Southwest Research Institute in Boulder, Colorado. And we have another plasma instrument called the Ion and Electron Sensor, which is another Southwest Research instrument from the San Antonio campus of SWRI. So that's our three instruments out of 26. And we have, well, not even a half. It's we also contributed some hardware to the Rosina instrument, which is from the University of Bern, which is just an incredibly capable mass spectrometer that we're very proud to be part of.
But Lockheed Martin built.
And Lockheed Martin in Palo Alto built those components.
Great stuff. Everything is working.
And everything's working. No smoke coming out of the back. Okay.
Okay. Can life survive in a comet? Scientific question.
Okay. Okay. The answer is probably, life is able to survive in some really strange environments, including so-called clean environments. We've discovered that here at JPL, in our clean room, which is supposedly clean, there are species of bacteria that have learned how to survive in there. So a whole new species, the clean people, have been able to survive detergent and other things. So life is really tenacious and, you know, able to survive. So I think there's almost nothing that, you know, if it figures out how to survive when bombarded with cosmic rays and ultraviolet light and all the... Without, you know, there's a lot of species of light that don't need oxygen to survive, even on Earth. There are, there's species that do photosynthesis for their metabolism, and there's species that do chemosynthesis for their metabolism, where they don't need the sun, and they don't need oxygen, and we don't need nothing. We just need certain chemicals that, in order to allow us to survive. So if we brought something to a cometary environment, it's not inconceivable that something might figure out how to survive. So,
and certainly comets, some scientists think that comets were these bodies that brought elements of life to Earth, not necessarily life itself, but the elements, you know,
the RNA-style molecules.
The DNA, amino acids,
yeah,
the
right.
Organic molecules, you know. If you look at the composition of your body and composition of a comet, you'll still find all the same elements. So,
well, not identical.
Well,
right? Because we
I'm
haven't,
not sure if we have cyanide in our body, unless not for very
right.
long.
Well, we haven't seen any organic material in a cometary environment, A, and then we don't know what we're going to see, okay, and whether that will be something that matches what we have in our bodies. But we're really interested. Okay, this is one of the reasons why we are there. Physics Nate asks, could astronauts or robots mine the ice on comets and turn it into hydrogen fuel? Not this comet, okay, because this one seems like it's more dusty than icy. And the volume of ice that's there would probably not justify the cost of sending a mining mission out to do that. But it's not inconceivable that there's an icy comet.
But we've seen composition of comets. There's roughly about 50% of water, 50% of dry ice, carbon dioxide. This may be, or 10%, 90%. It's always, there's a lot of water.
Right.
And water has hydrogen.
I just think that we have to be aware that this is a pretty extraterrestrial kind of an object. So when you think of water ice, you're thinking of what's in your refrigerator or freezer, you know, what comes out of the tap in your house, even if it's Los Angeles County water that comes out. And what we have in the comet is a really extraterrestrial material. It's water ice, quote unquote, but it's got some strange contaminants. It's got strange isotope signatures in it. And it's mixed in maybe intimately with this interplanetary dust component. So the actual mining part would have to be evaluated carefully for its cost effectiveness. OK, I think that's it.
Thank you so much for coming and sharing our evening with us.